Hello and welcome to this KubeCon CloudNativeCon North America 2025 preview. We'll be live in Atlanta in a short time, but today we'll be diving into one of the most critical areas of supporting organizations' journeys to AI, and that's storage. I'm really excited to be joined by Gleb Budman, who's the CEO and co-founder of Backblaze. Welcome on board, Gleb.
Thank you, Rob. Good to be here and looking forward to the chat, and also looking forward to KubeCon or KubeCon, depending on how we all pronounce it.
I look at it and I think as long as you show up, they really don't care. I think it should be CloudNativeCon because really Kubernetes, now being almost 11 years old, has really had its time. But one of the things that maybe folks don't know Backblaze is as much as KubeCon or KubeCon, depending on how you want to pronounce it. So why don't you give us kind of a idea on what you're focused on and how it was founded and came to be about?
So Backblaze is a cloud storage company, and we're basically creating the data backbone for the AI age. We provide really affordable, really fast, easy to use cloud storage. It's S3 compatible, and it's ideal for all kinds of applications, AI, media streaming, surveillance, and the like. We got founded because we started the company actually building a backup application, and we needed a place to put all of that data. We originally were planning on putting the data on Amazon S3. We realized we were going to lose money on every single customer. And so we ended up starting from first principles, figuring out how to take hard drives and attach them to the internet. We wrote our own file system. We wrote our own infrastructure as a service layer. We built our own platform, and we ended up designing this large scale, very efficient cloud storage system. And then customers came to us and said, hey, I want access to that. And so for the last decade or so, we've been offering Backblaze B2, which is our cloud storage offering for all of these application and AI use cases.
Yeah, I think you just hit the nail on the head. I mean, again, cost and affordability is one of the key things when we start talking to organizations. So let's kind of dive in there, because AI and data are, you can't have AI without data, and data has to live somewhere. What are you seeing from organizations as they dive down the AI path and really embark on this journey?
You know, it's fascinating. We've seen the entire workflow of what it looks like to build and use AI in their processing pipelines. So first, companies need to collect all the data that they want to use. Then they want to label it. They want to build their models. They want to then do inferencing off of those models. And then they want to log and track all of the information. And so we're seeing Backblaze be used in all of those different parts of the pipeline. One of the things that we're seeing, for example, is customers are spending on average 100 days at times training their model. So it's very expensive to use the GPUs for all of that training. And so they want to make sure that they have all the data ready and then able to get to those GPUs as fast as possible when they're ready to go. So the AI is being used across just so many different applications. We have customers using it for their surveillance workflows, in their using it to build and design buildings better, using it to do drug discovery. I mean, the number of places that AI is being used is amazing. And they're needing to create large data sets to train the models. And then the Gen AI part of it is also creating data sets itself. And then the inferencing workloads are all part of where I think all of this is headed. It's just going to become part of the fabric of the internet.
Yeah, and you're seeing some pretty significant momentum, I would expect, in this space as well. I'd heard like 70% increase in AI customers and over 40x growth in that data stored. But one of the things that was also important was that you had a new offering within B2, and it's called B2 Overdrive. Why don't you kind of help people understand why that came about?
That came about, B2 Overdrive came about because we were actually talking with customers and prospects and hearing this problem from them, which is that when they needed to accumulate all of this data and when they were ready, they wanted to get it to their GPUs as fast as possible. And it was very expensive to have those GPUs sit idle. And so B2 Overdrive, we believe, is the fastest throughput per dollar storage on the market. And so B2 Overdrive can give you up to a terabit per second of throughput at an affordable rate. And so customers are accumulating data, and then they use B2 Overdrive to get it to either one of the hyperscalers, one of the neocloud GPU providers, or even their own GPU clusters, and get it there as fast as possible.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, you hit the nail on the head again, because I like how you talked about not only the speed of it, but the cost of it, because I think one of the biggest issues we hear from organizations is the cost aspect of AI and how it can be so, you know, unpredictable, to put it mildly. What really sets Backblaze apart from this perspective in cost?
You know, we hear that a lot, and we've heard that from customers for years, that it's not just the cost, but it's the unpredictability. You know, these surprise fees, you're running your business, you're running your application, and then all of a sudden you get this bill afterward that is just shocking in nature. And customers are then not sure what to do in those situations. And so what Backblaze does is it's a fixed price point per terabyte per month. So as long as you know how much you're storing, you know how much it's costing you. It's also, we provide free egress. And this is one of those places where the traditional cloud companies often just get you with their fees, right? These egregious egress fees, because they're often multiple times bigger than even the cost of the storage itself. And if you want to take your data and you want to send it to even from one hyperscaler to another hyperscaler because you want to use their other GPUs, you're paying these egress fees. If you want to send it from a hyperscaler to a neocloud, if you want to send it from a hyperscaler and send it back on-prem, you're paying these egregious egress fees over and over and over again. And so Backblaze makes egress free. And we hear that over and over again from companies, that is a tremendous benefit for them, because they know, I'm storing this amount of data, I can get it where I want it and use it how I want it, and I can do that quickly, and I don't end up with some surprise fees on the back end.
Yeah, I agree. And I think one of the features I also like about it is the fact that the API calls, costs are out the window as well, which again, did at a company I was building a SaaS platform for, that caught me by surprise, was all the API fees associated with that and the egress, to put it mildly. Just a great, approach to this.
One thing, what I've also mentioned is that some companies, not all, but some companies also charge these delete penalties. And the delete penalties are something that are often surprise people, because you have your data, you're storing your data, then you delete it, and they actually charge you even after you've deleted the files, because they require you to keep the data for a certain period of time. And especially in AI workloads, but in most applications, there are some files that you're going to keep forever, there are some files you're going to keep for a month, and there are some files you're going to keep for a minute, and you don't want to be paying these surprise delete fees because of that as well.
Yeah, I think the folks at KubeCon will really understand that, given all the ephemeral workloads that they're dealing with in a lot of cases that may or may not be AI oriented, but as people build agentic applications, it's more than just the Gen AI side of it. There's all, traditional AI and ML, as well as other applications that are plugged in, which kind of brings me to a little bit more is, what are some of the key features that you see that Backblaze is offering that make a compelling solution to organizations as they become, more enterprise ready with this?
So Backblaze provides this enterprise ready cloud storage. And just at core, that's something that customers need, right? So you're running your Kubernetes cluster and you need your data somewhere. You don't want to store petabytes of data inside of each Kubernetes instance. So you really want that data source outside of it and plugging in to Kubernetes from the outside. So that's just the core cloud storage offering. Now, we provide a very durable, high performance, affordable version. And so that's an important part. But we provide a lot of enterprise-ready features. We have an enterprise web console. We have single sign-on. We have multi-region choices. We have ability to have lifecycle rules for compliance reasons. So there's a lot of enterprise-ready features and functionality in the Backblaze platform. And what I would also say is we believe in an open cloud environment. And what I mean by that is your data should not be locked into just a single hyperscaler. You should be able to use your data how and where you want it. And so we partner with and work with a broad ecosystem of compute providers, CDN companies, AI companies, the whole variety of organizations out there. And so there's an ecosystem built up around that you are empowered to use because you can get your data to wherever you want it to go. And so it's enterprise, Backblaze is enterprise ready and has a great ecosystem to support companies.
Yeah, I love that because I think, again, having built SaaS before, I remember for one customer, they had a use case where we were landing it on cloud storage, Azure, for them. And they're like, oh yeah, but we're using, you know, BigQuery over in Google. And now we need to move the data from where we landed in AWS over to Google. How do we do that cost effectively? And I'm like, well, you really don't. I'm like, you're going to pay for it, and you're going to pay for it to Amazon on the egress. You know, you'll get it into BigQuery for free, but you know, that's a whole different kettle of fish. I think that to me, as people build these out and look to alternatives to those hyperscalers, this becomes key to the thinking. Have you seen that with the customers is really that, hey, you know, we have these interesting use cases where we want to land the data once and use it many kind of things.
Yeah, and we actually, to that exact point about migrating the data from AWS to BigQuery in GCP, one of the things that we offer is a service called Universal Data Migration. And what Universal Data Migration allows customers to do is we will actually migrate the data from wherever it is, whether it's in Amazon or Google or Microsoft or on-prem or whatever, wherever you have the data, we will migrate the data to Backblaze. We will help subsidize the cost of the fees they charge you, those egregious egress fees. We will help subsidize those fees so that you can bring the data into Backblaze and then be able to use it wherever you want. And so if you want to use that your data inside of AWS with some services, inside of Google with some services like BigQuery, inside of a neocloud provider, you can do that and keep your data inside of Backblaze and then use it freely wherever you want. So with universal data migration, it makes it much easier for companies to do that.
I love that. I think that, you know, helps to unlock a lot of the value of that data at a better cost point for those customers. So, because I know customers, a lot of times they're making choices of do they keep the data or throw it out, to put it mildly. So I think that has to help them.
Yeah, and actually you make a really interesting point about that. It used to be a long time ago that it used to be that people would say, okay, I'm going to keep this data. I'm going to put this data in an archival, maybe on tape. And then at some point I'm going to throw it out because I'm not going to need it. One of the things that we're seeing a lot more of is because of AI, companies are realizing that that data has value and they need to be able to access it. It can't be stored in something that's inaccessible and they really don't want to get rid of it because it is often valuable later in ways they didn't even think about. So enabling you to keep that data and keep it on something that is active so that they can access it for either training or running inferencing on the old data is something we're seeing more companies want to do.
Yep, we're seeing that too. So I think that's a great place. So what's up next for Backblaze, and what has you excited for KubeCon North America 2025?
So I will say this is my first KubeCon, so I'm just excited to come and see what it's all about. One of the reasons why we're coming to KubeCon is it's where cloud native lives. And over the last 10 years, as you said, Kubernetes has taken over in a lot of the cloud native use cases, especially around AI. We help AI companies, we help cloud native companies with all of their data and all their storage and work and AI processing workflows. So we want to go there, talk to the big picture of AI, but also just specifically talk to all of these developers who are building cloud native applications. And, you know, we're going to be located at booth 1742. It's near the startup village area. In part, we wanted to be there because we're helping lots of startups with all of their new and innovative AI use cases. It's also near the meal break area. So hopefully in between meal breaks, people can come over and see Backblaze. One thing I'll mention is we also are giving away hot sauce. It's been the Backblaze spicy sauce has been quite popular. And we now have a special limited edition one that's the Overdrive version of that hot sauce. So hopefully people will come and I'll look forward to meeting some of them.
Yeah, I think you'll get a lot. I also think that, you know, I mean, I love the Linux Foundation and CNCF and everything like that, but you can never have enough spice on the food that you get at any venue. I would say that you gotta, this you're gonna be very popular with that. So if for nothing else, go there and get some hot sauce to go with your hot storage that you got going on back there. So really appreciate you coming on board, Gleb.
Rob, really good to chat with you as well, and we'll look forward to seeing you and everybody else there.
Yep, see you soon in Atlanta.
Thank you.
And thank you for joining today on theCUBE, our preview of KubeCon, CloudNativeCon 2025. We're going to be live in Atlanta really shortly. And, you know, thanks for joining us on theCUBE, the leader in analysis and news. Take care.